as we head into a new decade of cannabis, I'm wondering, what are some of the biggest challenges facing the sector in 2020? From a business perspective, have we seen the bottom of it? Greg?
Well, I hope so. Really, 2019 was a disaster for the cannabis sector in Canada. And I think it's really just getting going. And I think there's going to be a lot to rebuild investors' confidence in the space, because everyone got sold on these dreams of massive profits, massive revenues, and none of that really materialized in 2019. So the sector really needs to start almost retrench, go back to square one, and get going and prove out that the dreams that everyone had and they invested in originally are actually going to be materialized.
The biggest challenges?
I think a couple of hiccups, and you know, along the supply chain that we're kind of weeding, the sector is weeding to iron out. So the biggest being obviously Ontario retail, when's that going to open up? And the second thing, I think more broadly speaking, is the industry needs to really figure out what consumers like. I think that's a big thing that they haven't been able to do. And so now that we have Cannabis 2.0 actually coming online December 16th, so we'll see products maybe January, early February, that will give the industry a better sense of, okay, who likes what? What should I produce more of? And you'll see less of these returns as they get a better sense of demand supply.
Greg, you had just mentioned investors, and I'm wondering whether or not this is the point where they jump back in.
Well, I think from a time point of view, mid-December is usually a great tax loss selling opportunity to buy. And certainly when you've got a year like 2019, when so many other sectors had historically good years, and then all the losses have really been focused on cannabis and oil stocks, we're seeing a lot of tax loss selling concentrated in those sectors. So we might see a bit of a balance and rebound even into January for the cannabis stocks, just from a trading optics more than anything else. But it does feel like everyone really threw in the towel after the last quarter reports, because they were horrific. We saw a lot of inventory returns, a lot of inventory write-offs, and I think a lot of people said, "Just I'm out." And mm-hmm. and now we're gonna have to, and so that's a good capitulation sell that we've gotten in a lot of sectors. So, as Vamil was saying, we really need to fix the provincial retail model. It's hard to get confidence that any of these Canadian LPs are going to be able to put up numbers with, and you don't have Ontario stores rolled out. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of hope that next year Ontario will get their act together, roll out 1,000 stores, has been rumored, and you really need to go back to the fundamentals to get the excitement there.
One of the things I've noticed about dealing with the companies is that in late 2017, all throughout 2018 and 2019, they were very forthcoming with information. It was very easy to get a CEO on the line to talk to you and sell you on their business. That has completely changed. I think they're really quiet. They're really careful of what they're saying and the signals they're putting out to the market, because I think they're just getting the volatility, as you know, you mentioned, is just very, very strong right now. So I think one of the things going into 2019 is you're going to see cannabis companies dial back a little bit on the press releases, on the tone, on the hyperbole, and you know, that's something I think is probably wise.
Well, and I think we're going to see a big change in just management teams in general, that we've got to move from the stock promoting phase, that you're just there to put in a nice PowerPoint presentation and raise money. And now you need to focus on operators. And I think Canopy was the first to really make that change with the swap out from Bruce Linton to the Constellation management, and that was solidified this week. So I think you're going to see a lot more of the CEOs and management teams focus more on operations than stock promotion.
From a regulatory standpoint, are we going to see easing up, or are we going to see more rules? What do you think about that in 2020?
I think that, so Canada-wide, federally speaking, we have all the rules in place, so that's probably not going to change. I think the one factor that we shouldn't underestimate is the vaping health scare. And so now we've seen that two provinces, Newfoundland, I believe, and Quebec, have now said, we don't want cannabis vapes yet in stores, because we're not sure specifically what is in a vape pen that's causing these lung disease. And so the industry will tell you, hey, you know, this is why you should buy legal products, right? Because we're safe, we are pharmaceutically manufactured, we have all these Health Canada standards, nothing could go wrong. But I think the key thing to remember is that we don't know enough about vaping-related illnesses and the causes of it, and we could see that story playing out more into 2020, which I think might have an impact on cannabis products, but we'll see. There's something to keep an eye on.
So will that affect marketing even further?
Well, I think it has. I think vaping is a big thing that does have to be regulated, and people have to figure out what's going on there. But the big problem with the whole sector right now has been, I think the regulators thought that people would suddenly go to legal channels, and that really hasn't happened. There hasn't been the switch from the black market channels to the legal channels, and that's almost a case that you need to loosen some of the regulations, maybe allow some more product, some more branding, some more product awareness campaigns, and I think that's something that the regulators really messed up on, because when you want to look at the value creation, you've got the farmers and you've got a lot of the values created on the brand level. And in Canada, no one's been able to create a brand, per se. And I think that's where the regulators really need to pull back some of the rules. Still need to focus on safety of supply and safety of product, but I think they can lay off a little bit on the branding and the marketing and maybe even switch it to more product awareness.
I noticed one of the things, branding-wise, that Redican, the small private company that actually has done quite well in terms of their products, so what they've done is, in the lead-up to the Christmas season, one of their products is branded mistletoe. So they're kind of changing, they're so restricted in terms of branding, the only thing they can really do is kind of call their weed strain something different, right? And so I do agree with Greg, branding changes in regulation will be massive for the cannabis industry. But I still think that Health Canada is going to proceed very, very cautiously with this because of the pushback you're seeing from Quebec and the vaping scares and just generally the fact that we're only a year into legalization, and I think everything is just moving at a very cautious, slow pace. It could be politically problematic to also just say, hey, go ahead and brand, you know, the way you want it to brand. I know the cannabis companies have been lobbying very hard to get these marketing restrictions kind of removed, but they haven't made much of a dent in that. So
2020, a big political year south of the border. We expect some referendums in some of the states. And I guess we're expecting them to vote in favor of legalization. How does that change the picture for Canada?
Well, I think you can look at it both two ways. It's good because it's going to help the entire industry and make it more global and make it more legitimized, if that's a word, from the whole point of view that it's going to be creating the industry.
It's a new word for 2020.
It is, for sure. We'll make it one. And you're going to see more investors really come into the space as you see really big numbers and from a revenue perspective come out as Illinois ramps up and other states ramp up. But for Canada, it's also a bit of a negative that you're going to see these U.S. companies really come on strong, and they're going to be creating brands, they're going to be creating big products, and these are going to be big companies, and they're taking away the financing advantage that the Canadian companies had for so long.
Mm-hmm. That's an interesting point you make, Greg. I think the fact that a number of these states that might legalize recreationally are Republican strongholds is a big deal, because I think that signals then to the Republican Party that, hey, most of your base is very okay with marijuana legalization. Why not we just all get together and lobby and, you know, to get this done by November 2020 and make this federally legal. So I think that is what, politically speaking, that's quite interesting. And I think, you know, from now in the US, you'll probably see in 2020 the same kind of excitement and growth that we saw in 2017 and 2018 in Canada, if there is some sort of push and movement that really starts ramping up towards federal legalization there.
The timing is going to be really interesting, because it seems like this is a solution that has bipartisan appeal. The Republicans and Democrats both want to legalize cannabis. The problem is that no one wants to have the other party do it first.
Yes.
And the Democrats are hesitant to put the bill forward, because then Trump can sign this into law before the election and he can campaign that I did this. And the Democrats want to say, well, no, we want to campaign that we're the ones that are going to legalize cannabis. So the timing could be delayed a little further, but it definitely feels like the pendulum's moving well towards us.
I think the industry has kind of amassed key figures on their side. So John Boehner being part of Acreage Holdings on the board, I believe, and Mitch McConnell, his base in Kentucky, a lot of them are hemp farmers, and he really pushed the farm bill forward. So those two, you know, they have important figures on their side. So I think I think it could happen in 2020, and I think it would be massive and the biggest turning point for the global cannabis industry as a whole, because in a sense, everyone is kind of just waiting on this 300 million people market to stop being so fractured, right? Right now, it's just state by state.